Can you hear me? Anyone? Now, classically, again, the last discussion. Any question directly so that I can start with the what is the classical description of the state of the system? Let me ask questions. What is the classical description of the state of the system? I mean, what is the, classically, how do you specify state of the system? Position and momentum, they will specify the state of the system, isn't it? Again, if you have only one particle, position and momentum of that particle. If you have n particle, position and momentum of each particle, that will specify the state of whole system, am I right? Yeah, so that's a good idea. Again, we take that one as a point in phase space, am I right? Because a point in phase space will talk about position and momentum of all particle in the system, okay? Again, that is the specification of state of the system. A point in a phase space, it will specify the state of the system. What will specify, again, what we have chosen as a specification of quantum state of a system? Quickly. What we have taken as a specification of quantum state of this? Quantum numbers usually. Okay, usually wave functions are specification of state, but we have chosen quantum number. Why? That was quite easy. So then wave function. Obviously, wave function depends on quantum number only. Okay, that is the whole idea we have taken. So now the next idea was counting number of what you call states. So counting number of states and using that one to define any probability and all. So before getting into that one, I want to convince one small part. Any question in this part quickly? Spin is a degree of freedom, that's what I mentioned. What he's asking is, we have considered so many problems on spin, won't we take spin as a degree of freedom? That's correct, okay? I think, are you talking about classical this description? In classical, suppose a particle which is freely moving, okay, in space. Again, what we take? We take only 3 degrees of freedom, isn't it? Yeah, that again, let me tell you when that spin degree of freedom will reveal its existence, okay? Again, that will come in a quantum statistics. I think if you are talking about statistical point of view. So, can you elaborate that question quickly? So, this is a kind of discussion session, okay, because I have already put many ideas in the last session. Okay, only, so I mean, maybe 2 more classes we may need to struggle to get into the whole story. Then everything will have flow actually, okay? Yeah, quickly. Ganashyam, again, can you elaborate that question? Again, I couldn't get it properly. I mean, when you are talking about again a particle which is moving in 3 dimensions, I cap, j cap, k cap. So physically, a part again, not phase space, okay? Not phase space. Phase space again for a single particle in 3 dimensions, that is 6-dimensional space. Is that okay? Now, when a particle is moving, again, you say that particle have got again, suppose electron. You say that particle has got 3 degrees of freedom. Okay, you don't count that spin degree of freedom. Spin degree of freedom, its existence will be seen only after application of external magnetic field or interaction within them. Okay, that will reveal some different effect that we shall study in the quantum statistics. Okay. Yeah, we take only 3 degrees of freedom. That's a correct idea. But again, that spin degree of freedom, again, in classical statistics, we don't take that one. Okay. Only in case of quantum statistics, we respect that one. That's why classical statistics is not complete. It will not work for low temperature, high density like that. So, it will fail. We shall see that one. So, that is a clear negligence of spin degree of freedom only. So, as well as again, negligence of some more part actually. That's how we extend it to quantum statistics. That's a good question. Okay. We describe ensemble in which elements have same energy. Can we specify such ensemble in which elements have some their macro state like volume or any quantity? Yeah, again, your systems, again, your collection of ensemble. So again that need not to have total energy same. Okay, that can have total volume constant. Suppose if you take a cubical container. Okay, so take a cubical container. So now you have suppose n number of particles. That number is of the order of Avogadro number. Remember, number of particles of the order of 10 raised to 23. That is Avogadro number of the order. Okay, I am just talking about order. So you have gas in the cubical container. Okay, now what is the specification of state of the system? You should go, suppose if you have n particle, you should go for 6n dimensional phase space, am I right? The tau space, that was so whatever we talked about. So specification of the state of the system is specification of position and momentum of each individual particle, all n particle. Total degree of freedom is 3n actually, am I right? So each particle can move in 3 dimension. Okay, so now a point in phase space, a point in phase space, I hope I explained this part, am I right? A point in phase space, so 6n dimensional phase space, 6n dimensional phase space. A point in phase space, we will talk about, so position of first particle, position of second particle and so on up to position of n particle. Position vector I am talking about, that each position vector contains 3 coordinates again. And similarly, momentum of first particle, momentum of second particle and so on up to momentum of n particle. The same thing we have written in a different way. Do you remember? Q1, Q2 and so on up to Q, F, am I right? Suppose if you split this vector, individual R1 vector means x1, y1, z1. R2 vector means x2, y2, z2. R3 vector means x3, y3, z3, like that, isn't it? So, px1, py1, pz1, like that, okay? If you define 3 component of position, 3 component of momentum for all of the particle, okay? So, you will have this many terms, am I right? 3n. 3n position coordinate. x1, y1, z1. x2, y2, z2. xn, yn, zn. 3 times n. Isn't it? Similarly, you will have p1, p2 and so on up to p3n, am I right? Totally you have 6n coordinates actually, again, so 6n dimension. Again, that's bookkeeping, this part is bookkeeping. Phase space is pure mathematical concept, don't try to imagine. We can't imagine out of 3 dimension, can we? Is that okay? We can't imagine out of 3 dimension, this is bookkeeping term. This pure mathematical term, don't try to ever imagine that one. 6n dimensional, where n is of the order of 10 to the power 23, okay? Yeah. Now, again, one point in phase space, we will talk about position and momentum, various position and momentum of all particle, am I right? A point in phase space will specify the state of the whole gas, isn't it? So, in a given container, okay? So now, what I wish to again, now look at here. This whole gas, again, suppose it is isolated, it will have some average pressure P, it will have some volume, okay? It will have some average energy E, or sometimes we write it as U. Now look at here. So, how many microstates are possible corresponds to these average values? We call these things as a macroscopic property. Volume, average pressure, average energy, total number is also macroscopic property actually. But again, I'm taking isolated system, total number is not changing, is that okay? Now look, so again, it occupied some volume, okay? It have got some average pressure, isn't it? It have got some average total energy. So, how many microstates are possible corresponds to this average value? So, uncountable, isn't it? Because each of the particle, with respect to time, if you think, each of the particles are moving very randomly, isn't it? Again, when they move randomly, they are occupying different spatial point. They are having, again, after collision and all with other particle, they are having different momentum. Okay? So that's why again your face point is moving actually with respect to time, isn't it? Because again different position and momentum means that's a different face point, isn't it? Your face point is moving with respect to time actually. If that face point, we call this as face point, if that face point is representing state of whole gas, that face point is moving if you leave that one with respect to time. Is that okay? And again, it is again, once it moves, like, again, we call it in a phase space trajectory. Once it moves, again, that so trajectory, whatever we draw, we call it in phase space trajectory. One trajectory will have many points, am I right? One line, again, so mathematically, one line contains infinitely many points, isn't it? So that's why there are many microstate, uncountable number of microstate. So corresponds to this macroscopic property that can be volume also, that can be average pressure, so that can be average energy. Is that okay? Yeah. So this is pure classical description. Okay. Again, later we shall take again if you take electron gas or if you take helium gas or helium, I think helium 3, which is fermion. Okay. So they behave in a different way. So that is again, that cannot be seen here, there is a clear negligence of spin, okay? We shall see that one. Spin and statistics have got lot of connections that we shall take it in the quantum statistics part, okay? Yeah, microstates, yeah, that's correct. Again, one more question, wait a second, let me read out one by one. Sir, microstate exist on a phase space curve or inside the curve. There is nothing inside or outside the curve. Okay, again, so it will move and it will touch many points. Am I right? Because particles are moving very random. Now, each point on this what you call phase space trajectory is a possible state because our system is attaining that state at some particular instant of time. Isn't it? So that's why each of these points in the phase space trajectory is a possible state actually, not inside or something. Okay. So if you leave that one for a long time, your trajectory will cover some region of the phase space, isn't it? If you leave that one for a long time, remember that long time need not be hour. Sometimes it can be 1 minute. It all depends on the what you call the example. We should take some specific example. How long we have to wait so that it will cover entire phase space, remember. Is that okay? Again, if you take actual gas actually, the particles are moving so randomly that again it will cover phase space again with very less time actually. Many region of the phase space. Okay? Yeah, our phase point will move with respect to time and it will cover a lot of region of the phase space. Then we can say any point in that region is a possible state because our system have attained that possible state at some particular instant of time. Okay, so still I have taken isolated system here. Different microstate corresponds to same energy. Again, what she is talking about is, sir, we consider microstate corresponds to same energy in the ensemble. Okay. Suppose yesterday we were talking about so three particles are spin up, one particle spin down, and in that case I think your so total average energy, that's equal to 2 mu into h, am I right? So 2 mu into h, this is a kind of idea. So there are four possibilities, am I right? Spin up, spin up, spin down, spin up, spin up, spin down, spin up, spin up, spin down, spin up, spin up, spin up, am I right? 1, 2, 3. All of these four have got the same total energy. Okay, now it is a kind of degeneracy. That's correct. If you take total system as our system of interest, not individual. So there are four particle: first particle, second particle, third particle, fourth particle. Am I right? If you are treating all four particle together as your system of interest, definitely this E is equal to 2 mu h. This energy have got fourfold degenerate. While dealing with the probability, we do like this only actually. We put that degeneracy term. That's exactly correct idea. If you take total system, yeah, it is fourfold degenerate. Because so the total system, for a total system corresponds to this energy, you got four possible states, isn't it? Four possible wave function for a total system. We shall try to write the wave function later. Okay? That's a good idea. If you are finding total number of microstates from a given energy, so can we find applied energy if number of microstates is given? Not only number of microstates are sufficient to find the energy, okay? We need some probability concept. Number of microstates, that's not sufficient. We need some probability, we need much more theorems actually to find average energy. Okay, wait a second, let me talk about those things. Now, next question. If we know position and momentum of the system at one instant, we can predict the system at later. Is average value change when? Yeah, that's a very good question. Position and momentum of the individual particle is changing, isn't it? If we know position and momentum at one instant of time, again, Newton's second law says, again, we can find the position and momentum for later time, okay? But applying Newton's law for this much degree of freedom, it's quite impractical. How many particles we have? And they are colliding again. What would you do with collision? Isn't it? They are not moving freely, they are colliding with other particle, okay? So that's why we don't apply Newton's second law. That is the, again, because, so even though if you wish to solve Newton's second law, again, suppose by all struggle, you may need a supercomputer to what you call compute all of them. That may not be possible, because look at here, Avogadro number. You need to solve Avogadro number of differential equations, second order differential equation. So we don't go for that one, okay? We don't go for that one. Again, our system will become more and more complex when we increase the number of particles. We shall see in other sense, in the statistical point of view, again, our statistical outcomes or the average value where whatever we evaluate, that will have less fluctuation, less error if number of particle is high, okay? We have advantage by making total number of particle high in the other domain, okay, in the statistical domain. Wait a second, let me try to prove that one. Now, is average value change as phase point moving with respect to time? Now, look at here. At a time t equal to 0, this is isolated system, it is already in equilibrium, okay? So, then again, at time t equal to 0, I'll switch on the clock at some instant of time. I call it as at time t equal to 0. It is already in equilibrium. That means uniform distribution of the particle, uniform distribution of the what you call, so how to say, again, uniform temperature, all point in this region have got same temperature. So, like that, okay, it is already in equilibrium. If it is already in equilibrium, once it approaches equilibrium, so this average value will not change with respect to time. It may have small fluctuation, but it will not change with respect to time. That's how we take. That fluctuation will be very small, negligible, because the number of particle we deal with, that's of the order of 10 raised to minus, what you call, so 10 raised to 23. Again, we shall prove that later, that fluctuation will be inversely proportional to root of n, and we got the similar relation in case of binomial distribution, am I right? Relative fluctuation. Standard deviation divided by average value, that was inversely proportional to root of total number of particle. When total number of particle is high, that relative fluctuation, we call that quantity, again, I think I have written sigma divided by n1 mean, do you remember somewhere? We call that one as a relative fluctuation, okay? What I have said, that quantity? I think I haven't mentioned. I told I'll mention later, okay? This is called as a relative fluctuation, okay? Standard deviation divided by mean value. That will talk about width of the distribution, that will measure the width of the distribution. but that is actually relative fluctuation. Okay, the same thing is called as relative fluctuation. Anyway, we shall deal that one in a separate class. Okay. Now, what I am saying is, since we are dealing with a number of particles which is too huge, these average value, they will not change with respect to time once it attains equilibrium. Suppose if it is towards equilibrium, okay, suppose I'm grabbing all of this gas particle to one side of the cube and I'm leaving that one. Okay, then maybe pressure is also not uniform. Average energy is also not changing, isn't it? Temperature is also changing, isn't it? So that is not in equilibrium. It will approach equilibrium after some time. If you wait for some time, it will approach equilibrium. Is that okay? Again, that time that it takes to get into the equilibrium, we call it as relaxation time actually. You better to remember that word, relaxation time. The time that rough time that it takes to get into the equilibrium. Some system may take minute or hour or sometimes years of time to get into the equilibrium. Some system will take millisecond to get into equilibrium. It all depends on the situation. Okay, yeah, that's a good question. So that's why once it is in equilibrium, then if you think of phase space, phase point and its motion of an equilibrium system, okay, then definitely different phase point corresponds to same total energy, same volume, same average pressure. Nothing is changing. Even though it may have small fluctuation, that fluctuation is inversely proportional to root of number of particles involved, and that is, since it is too huge, that's why that fluctuation is of the order of 10 raised to, what is that, minus 10, minus, again, minus 23 means 10 raised to minus 12, like that, isn't it, under root. No, it need not to form closed loop, okay? Yeah. Next question is it necessary that it will have always closed loop? It need not to have. Okay? It need not to have any closed loop here. Next one. Phase space is a draw for total number of microstate or individual microstate. Phase space is a just imaginary space, okay? Position and momentum space. You should draw something inside that space to specify the system. Is that okay? One point in phase space will talk about only one microstate. Is that okay? One point in phase space will talk about only one microstate of the total system. Total system. Microstate is nothing but, again, that's again, you specify that microstate by specifying position and momentum of all particles. Am I right? Again, one point in phase space, it will talk about position and momentum of all particles of the system, isn't it? So that's why phase space is an imaginary space, okay? Again, you should take some region, you should take some curve over there, you should take some points over there to collect the microstate actually, okay? Yeah, so you were asking something, quickly speak out. Again, classical mechanics. Again, what he is saying is everything is originated from classical mechanics. That's correct, okay? Because we may not able to invent quantum mechanics without classical approach actually. I mean, without having the whole study. If there is nothing to fail, how you are going to win, isn't it? Yeah, obviously classical mechanics will fail. Yeah. Graphical representation of relaxation time. Again, I think that's quite difficult. Okay, I think we can do that one in phase space. Okay, in phase space, if the system is not in equilibrium, density of the phase point will not be uniform. Once it is in equilibrium, density of the phase point will be uniform actually. We can graphically represent that kind of relaxation time, but not, again, I think, are you talking about with respect to time? Should I plot something with respect to time, relaxation time? I'm not getting. Yeah, I think you again. I don't know exactly how that again. Again, we should have something which quantifies equilibrium situation. Okay, it is moving towards equilibrium. After some time, it will attain equilibrium. I think it will be exponential, because it takes quite long time for many system. I don't know what exactly the nature actually. First, we should have some quantification of state of equilibrium. Am I right? Again, it is moving towards equilibrium. That's what I'm saying. But I'm not saying that some quantity is approaching some value like that, isn't it? I think we better take fluctuations or some variation and all. Okay, yeah. Now, if you have a two particle, now again, yeah, that's a good question. If you ask more and more question, you will have more and more understanding, definitely. Suppose if you have two particle, will we get two phase space trajectory or only one? Now, look at here, we are drawing one phase space for an entire system actually. So, two particles, so each in 3D. What is the dimension of phase space? 6 is the dimension for one particle, isn't it? So, total 12 dimensional phase space, am I right? So, what is the degree of freedom for two particles in 3D? 6 degree of freedom, double that one, that is the dimension of the phase space, am I right? So, 12 dimensional phase space. Again, this phase space, each and every, again, if you have one trajectory, some arbitrary trajectory, that is for two particle system together, that is not for individual particle. Whatever the phase space trajectory I am drawing, okay, that is to represent dynamics of all particles of the n particle system actually, not individual particle. It's all left to you. You can draw different phase space for different, but we don't do that one here, okay. We draw phase space for, again, for a whole system of particles, not for individual particle. And each phase point will talk about information about all particles in our system. We take two particles as a one system here and we draw phase space for that one, okay. That is 12 dimensional phase space. We don't draw two individual phase space trajectory, okay. This is the phase space trajectory for n particle system together, remember. That is the idea. Bookkeeping idea, pure mathematical idea, don't try to imagine. Obviously, you can't imagine 12 dimension, isn't it? One point in phase space in case of single particle system, in case of one dimension, that will specify position and momentum. I think you haven't watched the last video properly. Again, if you take one particle in 1D, okay, then you have only one position and one momentum, am I right? That's a possibility. Then again, your phase space, you can even draw the phase space trajectory, am I right? X here, P X here. Now you can imagine that's a two dimension. You can draw one particle in 1D. What is the degree of freedom? 1. Double that one, 2. So phase space dimension is 2. Dimension of the phase space is double the degree of freedom of the system. Okay, don't take spin, as he said. Okay, don't take spin into account. Okay. So now again, each point will talk about one possible position and momentum, isn't it? And if you try to draw this phase space for I think particle in a linear harmonic oscillator, it will be ellipse. I think I have done this one in the last class, am I right? It's an ellipse actually. We shall deal with that one in our classical physics, okay? It's a good question. Wait a second, let me talk about division of the phase space little later, okay? That I taught in the last class, but division of the phase space into phase cell, I'll come to that idea little later, okay? Keep that question. So usually, Yeah, when it will attain equilibrium, that all depends on the situation. Okay, he's asking when it will attain equilibrium. If you start drawing this phase space trajectory with respect to time, how long you will draw? Again, when it will attain equilibrium, it all depends on the situation. Okay, if I want to quote that one, suppose, if you wait. Actual value of again relaxation time. Okay, we call that as relaxation time, the time that it takes to get into the equilibrium situation. So the time will depend on the particular, what you call, initial randomness also. Initially, if it is too much random, then it will take much more time to get into the equilibrium. One thing. So other one is it may require a year for a crystal of copper sulfate in a beaker of water to diffuse to produce uniform solution. Copper sulfate in a beaker of water to diffuse completely and to form uniform, what you call, concentration, all point in that solution should have same concentration. To attain that one, it may take a year. Yet pressure is but that there will be no difference in the pressure usually, am I right? Pressure equilibrium quickly, it will attain quickly because it's a liquid medium. So that's why if you think of concentration, it may take lot of time to attain what you call equilibrium situation. If you take some other quantity of interest, so it may get into the equilibrium in a millisecond sometimes. Okay, that's why it all depends on the situation. So how long it will take, how long we have to draw the phase space trajectory and all, okay? Now again, for quantum system, we don't draw phase space trajectory. Next question is, can we draw phase space trajectory for spin half system? No. For quantum state, we don't go for phase space trajectory, okay? So again, this phase space trajectory is only for particle which freely moves in a space. To discuss what you call spatial degree of freedom, okay? To discuss spatial degree of freedom, we use that one. Particle which moves usually freely or under gravity or under some external force like that, okay? We don't draw any phase space trajectory for quantum system. Obviously, quantum mechanically, specification of position and momentum simultaneously, it is not at all allowed. Our uncertainty will not allow that one. Uncertainty will not allow us to specify position and momentum simultaneously. That's why quantum mechanically phase space trajectory is not there. Okay, and even for spin half system, again we can't draw any phase space trajectory because those spins are not because of momentum, isn't it? Okay, here we can write our energy because of p square by 2m of individual particle, isn't it? And we can write our potential energy because of the position and all. We can do like that. But spin, you can't express like that. Again, that's a quite different story. Good question. After all particles, moment or change anything, the resultant volume or other parameter will contribute to phase space. Again, it's not a contribution to phase space. Each and every, again, if you take one possible volume, if you take one possible energy, if you take one possible, again, E, P and V, let me take one set of values, okay? For that set of value, again, if you leave the system, look at here. So if you see microscopically, a lot of zigzag motion is happening, collision is happening, momentum and position of all particles. So 10 to the power 23 number of particles are changing continuously with respect to time, okay? So that's why within no time, it will cover some region of the phase space. Region, you better talk about region of the phase space, okay? Not entire phase space. Again, if you leave that one for very long time, maybe it may cover lot of region in a phase space. Then we say, corresponds to this macroscopic property, there are many microscopic states. Corresponds to these are macroscopic properties, macro, MACRO, okay? macroscopic properties. Corresponds to that one, there are uncountable number of microscopic state. Microscopic state means each point in the phase space. Because once you take one the region of the phase space, region means it contains infinitely many points. Okay, that's why the division of phase space came to count the number of microstates. Okay, we shall discuss that one later. Yeah, the resultant phase space corresponds to this macroscopic property, that is one region of the phase space, okay, and we need to count that one, that is our next idea actually, okay, wait a second. Whatever the value of n there, 6 independent degrees of freedom. No, that is 6 n dimensional phase space. Again, degree of freedom depend on the number of particle and the dimension. Suppose you may have a graphene layer where your electron is moving, that become 2 dimension. Each electron is moving in a 2 dimension, that's a quite different story. But usually again we take the generalized situation, okay, degree of freedom that depends on the dimension in which the particle is moving, whether it is one dimensional region, whether it is two dimensional region like that, or three dimension, degree of freedom depends on number of particle, total number of particle in the system. Is that okay? Two particle in one dimension, what is the degree of freedom? 2. Each particle will contribute only 1 degree of freedom. Okay, that's how you have to define degree of freedom. Just watch last video lecture. Ensemble is a group of microstates with the same energy, so each phase space trajectory is represent different ensemble. Ensemble is a microstate with the same energy. Wait a second, I think your question will be solved. Ensemble is a concept. Again, actually I should have done that time and ensemble picture initially, then I should have gone for other one, okay. Ensemble, I'll take little later, okay? I'll take little later. Ensemble and how it is related to trajectory and all, okay? I think that confusion, that's very natural, that will be covered, okay? No. Again, even after attaining equilibrium, now look at here, his question is whether after attaining equilibrium, will our phase point remains at only one point? No. Even after equilibrium, equilibrium means these quantities are not changing, am I right? But for this quantity, again look at here, individual particles are in zigzag motion, isn't it? Once the particles attains different position and momentum, definitely our phase point will move. Even after equilibrium, our phase point will move and it will cover lot of region of the phase space. Okay, don't think that after attaining equilibrium our phase point will stop moving. It will not happen. It will keep on moving. Is that okay? Whether it is in the approach of equilibrium or whether it is after equilibrium, phase point will move with respect to time. Okay, that is the main problem. Okay, so we need to take again to find any average value, we need to take time average, am I right? Because our individual particles are changing its position and momentum with respect to time, then to find any of this average value, we have to take time average, isn't it? That is the difficulty, okay? If particles are interacting, then phase space dimension will not change, okay? That's a very good question. Will phase space dimension changes if particles are interacting? No, again, as soon as the particles are in three dimension, if any interaction comes, maybe phase space trajectory may be different. Is that okay? Or number of phase space region that it touches, that may be different. But again, even though it interacting, look at here, again, what you need, what is the ultimate information is position and momentum, isn't it? Because again, if they are interacting, you can define some interactive force. So again, if you define any interactive force, again you can express your energy. So in terms of momentum I is equal to 1 to n, am I right? So plus you can talk about some interaction energy, which is a function of their R1, R2 and so on actually. Usually we write it like this, okay? Then even though the system, this kind of system where it has a kinetic energy as well as potential energy, interaction we write it as a potential energy, isn't it? For any interaction we define a potential energy. Again, we still represent that one in the same phase space, okay? Yeah. Now, yeah, let me take you to again two main rules of this statistical physics. So just hold on your question, okay, for a time sake, so you can ask it later again. So now, suppose whatever the macroscopic property you have observed, okay, suppose if I take a volume, total average energy like that, okay, suppose I have a gas in a cubical container of volume V, it is attaining pressure P, okay, average pressure P, and it has total average energy E bar, okay. You have Avogadro number of particle, okay, again the same situation, you have Avogadro number of particle. Number of particles of the order of 10 raised to 23, okay? You have the same situation. Let me take similar situation. Now, suppose you have observed this one. Suppose this is one of the situation, okay? You can have a slab which contains spin half atoms, regular arrangement of the, so in a lattice, and you have applied external magnetic field. You may be talking about magnetization. Is that okay? That magnetization is a macroscopic property. Here, just like I am talking about average energy, volume, pressure. Here, we don't talk about volume, isn't it? Here, we don't talk about pressure, isn't it? We talk about magnetization, number of magnetic moment per unit volume, like that. Is that okay? That is the macroscopic property of interest, actually. Corresponds to this one, you may have lot of arrangement of spin up and spin downs, corresponds to net magnetic moment. I think I told this one, isn't it? This is where we apply that one, the whole story, okay? This is another one where we don't go for phase space here, but we go for phase space here. But this concept, whatever I'm proposing, that will hold here also. Wait a second. Now look at here. So let me take it as attained equilibrium. Okay, let me take it as attained equilibrium. Again, after attaining equilibrium, suppose if you measured any of these, okay, suppose if you measured any of these, the time you take to measure those macroscopic parameter, it will be always greater than millisecond. Can I say like that? Is that okay? Determination of pressure, dielectric constant, electric moduli, magnetic susceptibility. Those determination made normally over a time interval covering many millions of atomic collisions or vibrations. Again, if you are measuring this one, okay, if you are measuring this one, if you are trying to find the, again, if you are determining this one in any experiment. So again, need not to restrict to this one. I can talk about magnetization of the material when I place a what you call spin half particle, system of spin half particle in external magnetic field. Okay, that determination experimentally, it takes a time. Okay, within that time, maybe millions of collision might have happened here. Within that time, maybe one particle might have moved from one corner to other corner. Is that okay? So microscopically, that much change is happening. If you again, by the time you measure something, or time interval that you take to measure that thing, the macroscopic property, within that time, lot of things happened microscopically. Our phase point might have covered a region of a phase space. Is that okay? Now, so because of that, whatever the average value that you are measuring, that is a time average. The system is actually giving you the time average actually. You should take a time average. Suppose again, if I take again how to define that time average, isn't it? Again, we don't define, we directly go for that ensemble average and all. Wait a second, again, I need some symbols here. The time average you can write like this. Okay, again, suppose you have energy. Okay, suppose it may be function of t. That is because of each of your momentum of the individual particle of function of t. Okay, all of the particle of same mass. That's what I have taken. I is equal to 1 to n. Let me take non-interacting system. I have only momentum. Let me take for a time sake non-interacting system, isn't it? Now, since whatever the observation you are doing, that observation whatever you have done, that is over some time period, then you have to take time average, isn't it? So to take time average, you need to know individual momentum as a function of t. To find momentum as a function of t, you have to solve Newton's second law. How many Newton's second law you have to solve? Of the order of Avogadro number. That is absolutely impractical. So that's why, can I write again any time average over some time period t? The time period need not, again, that all depends on the situation again. Over some time t. Can I say like this, time average over some time t? So 0 to t f of t dt. Why can't I write like this? Just like you can apply here. Am I right? Average energy over some time period 1 by t 0 to t e of t. Yeah, you can do this one, definitely. Okay? But is it possible? I mean, you can do means, how to say? Theoretically, it is possible. Is it feasible? No. Because you need to trace the momentum and position of individual particle with respect to time. I mean, when you get momentum as a function of time, only when you solve Newton's second law. This is not possible. This is not feasible. Theoretically, it may be possible, but it is not feasible. You may need, again, as he writes, one of the author writes, we may need a truck of what you call initial conditions to solve the problem, isn't it? You have this many degree of freedom, this many differential equation. Each differential equation is second order, and you need two initial conditions. Again, I think the book is written in the 1950 or 60. He may be talking about truck. Now I can talk about a supercomputer that can hold all information. Okay, look at the age that has changed. That he has, again, same concept holds still, but what he has written is we may need a truck of papers and all to solve all differential equation like that. He said like that, but now we don't need that, isn't it? Technology has changed. We don't work with a paper now. Okay. That's a different story. But when you observe, this is what you obtained. Suppose if you wish to find that one theoretically, you need to do this part. That is not feasible. Yeah, generation gap. But we can understand the last generation, okay? Yeah. Now, what we do is, again, let me take equilibrium situation. Okay, I'll take the approach to equilibrium little later. Okay, let me take equilibrium situation. If you leave for a considerable amount of time, what will happen is, okay, let me take phase space. Let me take a phase space. Now, if you leave the system for some considerable time, what will happen is so it may be moving in a very random path actually. Okay, by the time that you have observed, it might have covered a region of the phase space. That's what I told. Am I right? By the time we have measured the time interval that we have taken to determine that quantity, by the time it might have covered a region of the phase space. Okay. Again, usually our phase point will move. We call it in this phase space trajectory, am I right? We take phase space trajectory, and each point in that phase space trajectory is a possible state. because our system attained that phase point, our system attained that microstate at some possible, at some instant of time in the middle of our journey, isn't it? Now look at here. So this is what happens with respect to time. Now what we are going to assume here is, we are going to assume all of these phase point, okay? We will try to make it countable, okay? This phase point, each of the phase point will talk about microstate, am I right? Different microstate. What we say is all of these phase point, they all exist one instant of time. Is that okay? All of, again, this is actually, our system is attaining this different point at different time, am I right? Okay, that is time variation picture. What we assume is, all of these phase point exist at one instant of time. We are going to imagine like this. And rather than taking time average, why can't we again collect all of phase point, and why can't we take average with respect to all of this phase point? Average of the quantity corresponds to all of this phase point. Average of the quantity corresponds to the different time, that is equivalent to average of the same quantity corresponds to all different phase point in our phase space trajectory. And this collection of all of these point, or collection of all of these possible microstate, we call it as ensemble. And taking average using these different microstate, we call that as ensemble average. We call this as time average. This is time average. Now, if you want to go for ensemble average, look at here, ensemble means, again, it is a collection of different microstate. Again, that ensemble contains very many, again, uncountable microstate actually. Because one line contains infinitely many points, isn't it, theoretically. So that's why, again, we take ensemble average. Again, that is equivalent to time average. This is the basic building block of the whole statistical physics. Okay. So there are some systems which don't follow this time average equal to ensemble average situation. That's a quite different story. So this is first done by Gibbs actually. This idea is proposed by Gibbs, which is very, very what you call, path breaking idea actually. Okay. Are you getting my point? We assume actually with respect to time our phase point is moving. We call that as phase space trajectory. Now what we are going to assume, at one instant of time we collect all phase point, all possible phase point which are in the phase space trajectory. Okay. Rather than taking time average, we take average corresponds to different phase points. We take average corresponds to different microstates that it has attained during that time. Both are same. Okay, we call that one as ensemble. What is the ensemble? So collection of all phase point, okay, that our system might have attained at some instant of time. Can I say like this? Or collection of all phase point that our system is going to attain at some instant of time. That is our collection of microstate, we call it as ensemble. Collection of microstate, we call it as ensemble. Is that okay? And we collect those microstate. Now remember, all of these microstate correspond to same macroscopic property. This is not changing. Even though phase point is moving, I am taking equilibrium situation, remember. It has already attained equilibrium. So when it is already attained equilibrium, even though you are talking about different phase point, that is because of particles are moving. They are attaining different position and momentum. That's why your phase point is moving. All of these microstates corresponds to same macroscopic properties actually. Ensemble is defined in this way also. Ensemble is a collection of all microstate correspond to same macrostate. So now whatever I have drawn earlier, spin up, spin down, spin again. What is that? Spin down, spin up, spin up, spin up, spin up, spin down, spin up, spin up. Spin up, spin up, spin down, spin up, spin up, spin up, spin up, spin down. Am I right? Four possible microstate correspond to total energy is equal to 2 mu into B. Am I right? this collection of this microstate, this is an ensemble actually. Four microstates are there in this ensemble, corresponds to same macrostate. All of this have the same total energy. All of this have the same total energy, okay? Are you getting my point? Now, how do you take that ensemble average? If I go for this one actually, to find ensemble average, again, I need to take what is the region that is it is there in the phase space and all. I need to count that one and all, okay? To find ensemble average, we usually do it like this. Wait a second, let me just give you one small theoretical idea here. Again, we write this one not in terms of time, we write that one in terms of P and Q. Obviously, you can write, again, P is the momentum, Q is the position actually. Actually, I should write F as a function of P1, P2, P3, Q1, Q2, Q3 like that, okay? I should write like that, but I'm not writing because I'm not taking all degree of freedom into my symbol. That's quite difficult, okay? F as a function of Q and P. Actually, F should be function of Q1, Q2, Q3 and so on up to QF, P1, P2, P3 and so on up to PF actually. Now again, so different microstate means different P and Q value. I better write that one, am I right? Let me write it for a time sake. Q1, Q2 and so on to QF. Similarly, P1, P2 and so on to PF. Any parameter, macroscopic parameter of interest, that is a function of this microscopic quantity, am I right? Position and momentum. Anything can be written in terms of position and momentum. That's the old idea, isn't it? Now you need to take average of this one, again corresponds to different microstates, corresponds to different elements of the ensemble, corresponds to different elements of the ensemble. What is changing? These Q1, Q2, Q3 and so on to Q, these Q and P's are changing. That's why you should take average like this. You should take average so that average will be taken in this way actually. Again, you can't divide or something, you should define one probability function here. You should define one probability function. I better to call that probability function, a kind of probability density. Next idea is, it is not taking any average in a, like this, 1 by t into 0 to t like that. We can't do like that. We define one probability function, probability density, rho, as a function of Q and P. Even though I am writing Q and P, this corresponds to all of this, okay? Symbolically, I am writing like that, okay? And dq1, dq2, and so on to dqf, dp1, dp2, and so on to dpf, okay? So, this is probability of finding the system in the small region of the phase space, actually. This is actually small volume of the phase space. I think yesterday I talked about that one, am I right? Volume of the phase space, dq1, dq2, and so on. Again, this whole thing is a probability of finding our system in that volume of the phase space multiplied with this quantity f of q and p, okay? This is how we take the average in case of phase space situation. We shall deal with that one later, okay? Later we shall deal with that one. This is nothing but a kind of ensemble average only. Because we take average corresponds to different microstate, but we don't do like this, but we take one probability function, we define the region of the phase space, and using that one we take the, what you call, that's how it is connected to probability actually. To find this probability and all, we need to count the number of states. To find this probability function, you need to count number of states, that's the need actually. So that's why the whole idea is, the whole idea is time average that is equivalent to ensemble average. This is the very basic idea. Now remember, this average pressure, total volume and energy, this all are result of all particle together. I am not talking about average energy of one particle here, this is average energy of total system. even though individual particles are moving with respect to time, again, even though position and momentum of individual particles are changing, remember these are not changing. I am taking isolated system at equilibrium. So that's why his question is, again, even though microstates are changing, am I right? Why our energy remains constant? That's what I am saying. Microstates are changing because individual position and momentum are changing. This is isolated system. It is already in equilibrium. Total average energy is constant even though individual particle attain different position and momentum. Some particle momentum may be increased. Some particle momentum may be decreased. Somehow it will compensate to give total energy constant. Okay? I think right now, again, he is talking about how many averages are there. I have written here time average and ensemble average. I think I know only these two. You can come up with a new idea if you have any. Then that may be theory similar to statistical physics, isn't it? Yeah, in quantum system also, we do the same thing. But we don't do it in the phase space because phase space is not, again, phase space trajectory is not allowed quantum mechanically. But we do this probability stuff. We count number of states. We deal with the probability stuff. Is that okay? This is how actually ensemble average should be taken actually by not actually collecting. Again, you can't have all possible position and momentum. That's quite difficult. Again, that's quite difficult information, isn't it? Even though if you are talking about ensemble average, collecting all that microstate and then talking about average, ensemble average corresponds to all very many uncountable number of microstates, that's also quite lengthy, isn't it? That's why we go for probability stuff. And we continue that probability idea even in case of quantum mechanical system, even though we don't go for phase space. That's again time average equal to ensemble average. So here, when I write this statement, I am not talking about phase space at all. Phase space in case of classical system, something else in case of quantum system. Is that okay? Now, okay, one more point, okay, one more point, then I think we can proceed later. Time average equal to ensemble average. So now, suppose if you take isolated system which is already at equilibrium, okay, isolated system which is already at equilibrium, that's what I have taken. Now, that will cover some region of the phase space, am I right? That will cover some region of the phase space or isolated system, isn't it? That will cover some region of the phase space, okay? And corresponds to that region, you have very many phase points, okay? After, again, if you leave that one for a long time, that long time may be 1 hour, is that okay? For this system, maybe within 1 hour, one particle might have covered all region of this cube. That fast they are moving, isn't it? Either again, it's quite difficult to guess that much numbers, how much time it will take to cover some region and all. Okay, quite difficult to guess those numbers. But what I can tell is again, after some time, again, after some time period, it will attain some region of the phase space. Okay, it was at equilibrium. Okay, after attaining equilibrium, I'm just talking about this one. It has attained this region, okay, and each of these phase point is corresponds to possible microstate, okay. All of these phase point corresponds to same total average energy, volume and pressure. That's not changing. That's not changing. Don't think that different phase point corresponds to different total average energy. Maybe different phase point corresponds to different energy of an individual particle, because position and momentum of individual particles are changing. Somehow they are compensating that one to total energy. Okay. Now, at equilibrium, isolated system. Now the question is, Again, if you just measure in which microstate the whole system is, okay, yes, at some other instant of time, after some time, if you measure at which microstate the whole system is, okay, that measurement outcome is very random. That means all microstates are equally probable. No one microstate is favored. Isolated system at equilibrium, all microstates are equally probable. You look into the system at any one instant of time, there is nothing in mechanics to say that this possible microstate is more probable when you look into the system at some instant of time. Okay, that is the another what you call idea. Can you just write it down? An isolated system in equilibrium an isolated system in equilibrium is equally likely to be in any of its accessible microstate. Any of its accessible microstate. Is that okay? There is nothing in mechanics to say that this microstate state is more have got more probability when you do observation. There is nothing in mechanics to say that this has more probability than other. Okay, suppose. Again, after long time, if it covers some region of the phase space, you can't say that in this region you have more probability, in this region you have less probability. Actually, our Liouville theorem also says the same thing. Density of the phase point is same. That's how it says actually. Okay. Anyway, we shall not get into that one again. Quite difficult to prove. Yeah, but again, look at here. This need not be phase space and classical system. That can be our spin-off system. Am I right? Again, so let me take the same situation: spin down, spin up, spin up, spin up, four spin up particle. Total energy is equal to 2 mu into b. Spin up, spin down, spin up, spin up, spin up, spin up, spin down, spin up, spin up, spin up, spin up, spin down. Is that okay? All of these states correspond to same macroscopic property. I call this as macro. But actually, we don't deal with three or four particle. Either we deal with Avogadro number of particle actually. Whatever. Now look at here. These are different microstate. Am I right? At one again, this is first particle, second particle, third particle, fourth particle. Okay. All of these microstates are equally probable at any one instant of time. Suppose if you look into that four particle system, okay, you can't say that you are more likely to find here this one, less likely to find this one. You can never say like that. All are equally probable. You can find any of these if you do the measurement. Anyway, we don't do that one, obviously. Okay, but that is the other building block actually in case of isolated system at equilibrium. All of these states are equally probable. If you do measurement, spin measurement of individual particle, you can't say that again you are more likely to find this state, this microstate than this state. You can't say like that. All of these microstates are equally probable. Okay, all of these microstates are equally probable. Now read the statement again. I think you can apply the same thing here also. You can apply the same thing here also. That's why ensemble average equal to time average and isolated system at equilibrium, it will be equally likely to be found in any of the accessible microstate. These are independent of whether you are defining a phase space or whether you are talking about quantum system. I think that is sufficient as a basic building block. Then I think I can go for dividing phase space and counting number of states and all. So try to read the whatever the example that he has given in a black box of Reeve. Okay, those are quite important. And again, so I'm expecting all of you to submit the homework as soon as possible. Okay. Yeah, next session, let me just alert you. Okay, I think at 8 o'clock, or I may upload on video also, because I need to again, just like what I did now, again I need to make it quite simple, and I need to come out with some different ideas. Yeah, we shall see. Let me just check out some videos and let me upload, or let me come online again at 8 o'clock. Okay. Yeah. Any question quickly. We call if the system which follows time average equal to ensemble average, that's what we believe. All system follows like that, and we proceed. Okay. Again, we call that kind of system as ergodic. Is that okay? The system which do not follow that one, we call that one as what you call non-ergodic. Yeah, I think that word is not needed in the book. He mentioned, that's why I mentioned that one. Sometimes in the question they may define that one. Okay. It is not phase space is moving. What he is saying is how the phase point is moving after it attained equilibrium. Look at here, gas in a cubical container. Even after equilibrium, whether the particles are stationary, are they stationary? No, isn't it? Even after equilibrium, they are doing zigzag motion, am I right? They are attaining different position. Position, suppose if you take origin somewhere here, position vector of individual particles are changing, isn't it? Are they stationary? No. Do they have same momentum even after attaining equilibrium? All particles have the same momentum? No. Again, they are colliding, they are changing the direction. Both magnitude and direction of the momentum are changing. That's why, again, phase point, which is one phase point, corresponds to one set of these values. Since this set of values are continuously changing, phase point is moving. I hope you got that idea. Quickly reply. I think this will not take that much time, just like quantum mechanics, okay? I mean, quantum mechanics consume a lot of time, but this will not take much time. I think maybe one more class we may struggle, but again, by that time we will, again, what he is saying is there is a statement which says that it is impossible for any isolated system to come to the equilibrium. Okay, so it may be because of exponential relaxation time. Again, with respect to time, it may be coming to equilibrium exponentially. Exponential curve is like that, am I right? It will never touch the axis. It may be because of that one. Okay, just look into that one carefully. But if we wait for a sufficient time, it will attain the situation where these values will not change considerably over time. Then we can say that is an equilibrium situation. When this value do not have much time variation, we can say it attained equilibrium. Now, I think we need 5 more days of the next month, okay, to finish the whole topic. Today is 20th, am I right? I may take 1 or 2 class even during Ganesh Chaturthi, is that okay? You don't have to come if you have any function, okay? Let me manage. Is that okay? And on Sunday also, we shall skip one Sunday test. Anyway, we need to have some more thing to be covered in the syllabus to have a test actually. Yeah, I think I'll take afternoon session to solve some Poisson distribution problem, because if any question appear, then you need to able to attend that one. Okay, Poisson distribution, not much application of that Poisson distribution, but we better to deal with how to apply that one. Okay, how far these classes mention problems? I'm not getting. Again, for right now, I think you don't have much homework. Right now, you don't have much homework. Try to plot phase space trajectory for linear harmonic oscillator particle in one dimension linear harmonic oscillator. I think you better to read out that one. Okay. Again, today you don't have homework. From tomorrow, you will end up with lot of homework. That's why finish out the last homework that I have updated. I think that problem of two person doing random walk, that was quite difficult problem, that is solved in yesterday's class. Okay, apart from that, I don't think any difficult question is there. Only Poisson distribution, that I am going to do it in the afternoon. Okay. Yeah, definitely. Again, you can attend November 2nd week, am I right? CSIR is November 2nd week or 3rd week, 2nd week. Yeah, by 2nd week, we will have lot of syllabus to be covered, okay, even electrodynamics also. But the problem is you may not have much time to do revision. If you do revision yourself, then definitely you can have a good attempt. Or attend the next batch revision that I am going to start within a couple of days. I am going to start next, again, last, not next batch, previous batch revision, okay, 1 hour per day. You better to attend if you can manage time. If you quickly finish out homework, you can attend that revision, so that I don't have to do that revision again in the month of December, in the month of December or November to December. Let me do revision of only electrodynamics and last part, whatever we have covered. This beginning part, you better to join a revision of old batch. That's a good idea. Situation is not clear, as I said, definitely. So we can't predict much. Okay. I think battery may take some time to charge up, okay? It may take some time. Let me reply, okay, in Slack. Electronics we will cover before TFR, but I am not sure about solid state physics, but some part of solid state physics are covered in statistical physics, thermal properties, which are covered in statistical physics, all thermal properties, okay? And if you, again, soon after that CSIR part of the syllabus, whatever I have planned, soon after that one, if possible, let me take some classes on, depending on the situation. If suppose CSIR exam postpones and all, we shall continue so that before TFR we can cover solid state, okay? I think if you need, I can share the videos on that crystallography that is ready actually. That's quite a good discussion that I have done. Or again, we shall try to make it quite exam point of view. Solid state physics, we shall try to make it pure exam point of view. We shall try to guess some question and we shall try to tackle those questions. Because theory, it consumes time actually. Okay, that's a good idea. Yeah, for TIFR, optics is also needed, Newtonian mechanics also needed. That is the problem. In the whole course, whatever I plan, I can't make it before TIFR. Isn't it? But you can plan for just as well as JAM, GATE, isn't it? TIFR, they take through just also. It's the first week of December actually. TIFR exam is the first week of December. Then to cover the whole syllabus and to do the revision, I think I may need to spend again within 3 to 4 months. I should cover the syllabus. That's not possible. I thought of that one. I thought of that one earlier. Okay. But if you do revision parallelly by the end of November, since most of our syllabus is covered, if you do revision parallelly, you can have a good attempt for TIFR exam. Okay. We shall do one thing, for solid state physics, we shall have an exam point of view discussion, not theory discussion, okay? So that again, probably you can able to answer some question, okay? Yeah, that's a good idea.